Greetings and welcome to the pre-concert video for Beethoven's Triple Concerto. This is airing on February 18th, 2021. I'm your host, Bob Fraser, the bass trombonist in the Victoria Symphony. Thanks to all of you who have been joining us online when these concerts air. It's been fun interacting with a few of you in the chat, which is something you can't do at a live concert. Now, back in the fall, when we performed Schubert's Fifth Symphony, I shared a lovely image by the Iranian artist Hadi Karimi. Do a Google search of that name. He's done a number of beautiful 3D portraits of composers using known contemporary portraits and verbal descriptions of the composers. So here's his portrait of Beethoven. I find this to be quite intriguing. Contemporary accounts of Beethoven suggest he had a very dark, swarthy complexion, which I think Karimi has captured really well here. So we have just a single work of this time. This is the Triple Concerto of Beethoven. As you may have guessed the obvious, a triple concerto has three soloists, in this case a piano, a cello, and a violin. Now, we rather confusingly call this combination of instruments a piano trio, something that's always bugged me since I was a young person, that the violin and cello are completely left out of that title, but that's what we call them. There are a lot of chamber music pieces for this combination all by itself. Pretty well all the major composers from Haydn and Mozart onwards wrote for piano trio. But very few pieces where it's a concerto group with the full orchestral accompaniment behind it. Now, it's been suggested that Beethoven wrote the Triple Concerto for one of his own students, the Archduke Rudolf of Austria, this dude here. Rudolf was the dedicatee of a number of Beethoven's works, including one of his piano trios, Opus 97, which was called, quite rightly, the Archduke Trio. And as you might be able to tell from all the red in this portrait, Rudolf eventually became a cardinal in the Catholic Church. Now, one of Beethoven's biographers was convinced that Beethoven intended the piano part of this triple concerto to be played by Archduke Rudolf, but there is no evidence that this ever happened. We don't know why. Instead, the final dedicatee of the triple concerto was this fellow here. Joseph Franz Maximilian, 7th Prince of Lobkowitz. Now, he was a very important patron of Beethoven's, and he was not only the dedicatee of this concerto, but he was also the dedicatee of Beethoven's 3rd, 5th, and 6th symphonies, among other works. He lived in this palace, shown here. This was built on this site between 1685 and 1687. Now, the site was formerly known as the Pig Market, and I'm sure that had some effect on the real estate prices at the time. Maybe Lobkowitz got a deal on this land. But anyway, this palace still exists in modern-day Vienna. Here it is today, and you can see that by the posters in front of it that its place in musical history is obviously still very important. Now, it's quite likely that the Triple Concerto had its first private performance in this room. Now, this room is called the Eroica Saal, and it's so named because the very first performance of the Eroica Symphony, which is Beethoven's 3rd symphony, also took place in this room in the exact same part of the year, in the summer of 1804. And I grabbed this image from the Vienna Convention Bureau website. Now, today you can actually book the Eroica Saal if you want, for a wedding or whatever. I think that it would be really cool to get married in the room where so many famous pieces of music were first heard. Now, Beethoven's Triple Concerto is laid out like a very, very typical classical concerto. And I've explained these in a lot of these talks. The themes are presented by the orchestra first in a very long introduction. Then they're passed to all of the soloists, and it unfolds very much like I've explained to you in classic symphonies. The themes are presented, then they're developed. That is, they're fragmented, improvised upon, as it were. And don't forget that all of these composers were great improvisers, especially Beethoven. It often helps when you're listening to this music to think of Beethoven literally riffing on these themes. And then at the end of a movement, they're restated again. And the Triple Concerto is a very regal piece of music. It's very stately and unfolds very, very carefully. And for me, the really interesting thing, I think, is to contrast it to the works written in the exact same year, at the exact same time. So, for example, here's the opening of the third symphony, the Eroica Symphony. Beethoven basically hits you on the head with two big E-flat major chords and then launches right away into the first theme. So here's this. After that, there's the Waldstein Piano Sonata. This was also written about the same time. It's for solo piano. This starts with this relentless torrent of repeated notes. Now, the triple concerto, however, starts in the lower strings of the orchestra, and instead of, you know, hitting you right over the head, it very gradually draws you in. The thing to listen for here is just how long it takes the piece to build. I think it's because of this really drastic contrast between the triple concerto and its neighboring works from the same period that critics haven't been all that excited about the triple concerto, which I think is totally unfair. Just because it doesn't have the immediacy of these other works doesn't give it less merit. Now, one of the benefits of this horrible pandemic we're living in is that we're doing these shorter programs, and I'm really glad that we're presenting this work on its own, all by itself, in this format, because it's the perfect Beethoven work for watching in a video format. It was a video performance with multiple camera angles, so you can see all three soloists, and because it's a recording, we can let it live online for a while so you can have multiple listenings, and that's true of all of these programs. We're also lucky to be able to perform this in a pandemic. Even in non-pandemic times, this concerto kind of relies really heavily on an orchestra's ability to have a violinist and a cellist handy who could collaborate well with a local piano soloist, which thankfully we have with Terry, Brian, and Lorraine, all of whom, by the way, are featured on other programs during this virtual season. You've already heard Terry play the Four Seasons. You're going to hear Lorraine and Brian both very soon. Otherwise, when you perform this, you have to bring three soloists in, which is impossible at this time. And that's probably why, even in normal times, this concerto isn't performed as often as any of Beethoven's concertos for single instruments, especially his five piano concertos or his violin concerto. It's just a lot easier to do when you don't have to bring three soloists in. So this is a slightly shorter talk this time. I hope I've given you something interesting to think about as you enjoy Beethoven's triple concerto. Just let this unfold very slowly before you as you enjoy it in your home. Thanks very much for tuning in.